Hello and welcome to Insight Indonesia, brought to you by the Jakarta Globe. I'm your host, Lynn Newman. And this morning we're talking about getting your kids into the right school. And when we talk about right schools, we're talking about very, very good schools in the United States. My guest is Jason Ma, who is the founder and CEO of a company called 3EQ, which does precisely that, help people figure out how to get into Harvard and Yale and Berkeley and cool places. Jason, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Let's start by having you tell us what is 3EQ.
Okay, 3EQ means three things. Number one, we help mentor young leaders, which is the same theme that I have as a Forbes contributor. So part of what we do is to help bring out the best, the genuine best in students, and help them become the authentic best that they can be as a student, as a whole human being, and help them maximize chances for getting to the top tier universities, especially in the US, and help them prepare for a meaningful career. And number two, we work within the strategic triangle of the student, the parents, and 3EQ, and we count only to this triangle. Mm-hmm. And number three is, EQ to me means more than just emotional quotient. It also means emotional, social, and also leadership intelligence.
Well, of course, we grew up, you and I, with measuring simply IQ and saying, mm-hmm. somebody has a high IQ. But EQ has come on in recent years as something that kind of measures a more complete human being who
yes.
has able to actually take that high IQ and use it.
Right.
At least that's the way I interpret it.
Well, when you fast forward to these future young leaders, right, or future leaders who are now young leaders, I call them, or grooming them to be young leaders, you take a successful CEO in the 30s, 40s, 50s, what's it all about in order to be successful? It's about EQ. It's about executive intelligence. So today, younger use emotional intelligence. It might be a little bit smarter. So in addition to having strong management skills, which is really taking from point A to point B, more methodical, systematic ways of solving problems, you also have to have that EQ component. Steve Jobs is an extreme example of an extremely high EQ person. Mm-hmm. And then Tim Cook now has developed to be a great high IQ and high EQ person mm-hmm. at a far right quadrant as both a leader and a manager. So I think the combination is a very powerful one.
It's an interesting thing. Now, the other thing, and I was reading some of your writings, you were a columnist for Forbes magazine and various other places. You talk about the working with high net worth individuals. Mm-hmm. And you work with, I know, Asian clients, high net worth individuals in Asia. You know, the common guy would tend to think, oh, high net worth, what do they need help for? They
right.
got it all made.
Right.
But that's not necessarily the case, is it? What are the kind of special needs or special requests that you get from high net worth people that you work with?
Right. First of all, humbly speaking, I hate to say it, but that's what I do in business. But I do community service, mm-hmm. serving the disadvantaged. That's pretty important. And a long-term goal of mine within my overall vision is to found a foundation, 3EQ mm-hmm. Foundation. And I'm committed to donate a 1% of my net profit in 3EQ to foundations.
To also work with kids who are very promising,
right.
but maybe don't have the financial means.
Right. So I'm taking a page from my friend Mark Benioff of Salesforce.com, who is one of the billionaires that I know, and he's been donating 1% of net profit mm-hmm. to people. I do that too. Mm-hmm. Now, what was your question again? I forgot.
Well, what are the special needs of high net worth individuals?
Okay. Let me put it this way here. If the world is perfect, and that's a fantasy, mm-hmm. okay? You take 1 × 1 × 1 = 1, isn't it? So you take the student, you take the parents, you take the principal, you take the wonderful college or university counseling centers mm-hmm. in the best private high schools. Most of my clients tend to be kids already going to the best private or boarding schools mm-hmm. in Asia or US or wherever, okay? So people wonder, why do they need help, right? I'm getting the best education, my parents are paying big bucks to send me blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But the reality is that it's more like 0.8 times, if you're lucky, 0.9 mm-hmm. times 0.7. Then the net product is more like 0.5 because kids are kids, emotional, right?
Sure, sure.
And then there are decisions that are made based on advices or based on their thinking or mm-hmm. parents' mm-hmm. influence that are suboptimal. I see that all the time. So a lot of parents and kids and also advisors that I see out there, when they make certain decisions, they have the best intention in a narrower context, but they don't know what they don't know. I see that all the time. The people don't know what they don't know syndrome. My clients tend to be CEOs, managing directors, mm-hmm. government leaders, general managers, celebrities, all sorts of successful senior executives, right? Or TV anchors, right?
And I'm not a high net worth TV
anchor. Or whatever, right? And you know, and kids are kids. If kids right. are motivated, and I'm pretty picky too. I pick clients that I like, who like me, right. chemistry. So I pick kids that are still achievers, who want to thrive, who want to grow.
We're going to have to take a break yes. there. But when we come back, I want to talk about how you work with those kids and also a little bit about why U.S. education remains attractive to so many people. You're watching okay. Insight Indonesia, brought to you by the Jakarta Globe. We're talking with Jason Ma about getting your kid into the right schools. Stay with us. Welcome back to Insight Indonesia, brought to you by the Jakarta Globe. Today I'm talking with Jason Ma of the group of the company 3EQ, and they work with kids and parents to get their children into good universities. One of the things that you specialize in, obviously, is U.S. elite U.S. universities, Stanford, Yale, Harvard, places like that. Why U.S. universities? Why should somebody still pick a United States university?
Okay. Well, first of all, I work with families that who could be preferring whatever universities, right? There's a lot of wonderful universities in Asia. And if families like to go for them, for example, NUS in Singapore, HKU in Hong Kong, Tsinghua Beda in China, right? Korea, and then Tokyo University, IIT in India. Wonderful universities. But I'm seeing that a good portion of the families in Asia, probably increasing right now, that still prefer to send kids to wonderful universities in the States. Now, as for myself, the background reason is I'm an immigrant Chinese. I'm an immigrant Asian to the US. Mm-hmm. So I have an immigrant, hardworking, work smart mentality. I'm also American. I've been living in the States for 38, 39 years. So in a way, I'm not just Chinese American. I'm both Chinese and American, mm-hmm. Asian American in one
sure,
brain, right?
Sure.
So what I deeply believe in is combining the power of Asian discipline mm-hmm. and Asian cultures with American creativity. In other words, you look at Asian values, right? Family, mm-hmm. education, respect for elderly, and also privacy. And then you combine that with the dynamic American creativity mm-hmm. and lateral thinking usefulness that you pick up from a strong liberal arts education. It doesn't mean design arts, right? It could be
sure.
anything.
Economics, of course.
Psychology,
well, these are the kinds so. Of kind of reasons that Asians really have transformed
yes.
the University of California system.
Mm-hmm. It's about 40-45% right now.
Yeah,
I'm a UC Berkeley product.
There you go.
Right? I was a Berkeley engineering product. So, you know, in California, it's about 11% Asians, I think.
Something
it's about
like that.
4% Chinese, or you know, it's less than 10%, far less than 10% Asians in the U.S. Right.
right?
So even for Chinese, it's actually a very small minority in the States here. But you look at California, you look at University of California, Berkeley, L.A., San Diego, Irvine, right? So 45, high 40s. Mm-hmm. Right now, actually, the percentage of certain East Asians is being trimmed, as we speak right now. Mm-hmm. So it's getting more and more brutal if you are Chinese or Korean or
right, because,
South Asian.
Right, because they don't want it to be. Homogeneously Asian
yeah.
or something.
I'll reserve my comments.
So. I'm a Californian myself, so I'm familiar with some of that debate. But the thing that sometimes surprises people is that for all the talk of the U.S. being in decline, our universities, I say our, I'm an American, mm-hmm. our universities continue to be very, very competitive internationally.
Mm. It is crazy. Okay, I feel for the kids. I feel for my high school students. I got one of those at home. I got two daughters, mm-hmm. and she's a high-achieving high school sophomore, taking two APs, top-ranked, and she's going through her stresses and pressures right now. So I encourage the audience and yourself mm-hmm. to look at my latest Forbes article,
okay.
which just came out yesterday, in fact. It's called Why to Start College in Sixth Grade. And I talk about the importance of starting while you're a little tweeny, like my second daughter, mm-hmm. who's an 11-year-old. Mm-hmm. The point that, you know, life is not about car jobs. That's not the point. The point is that you want to be, you want to become as good of a person you can be, as a human being and as a student, academics and also non-academics. Mm-hmm. In order to get into some of these elite schools, you know, I do all eight. I've coached hundreds of students who are now attending all eight mm-hmm. Ivy League schools: mm-hmm. Stanford, MIT, Caltech, Berkeley, UCLA, Northwestern. The list goes on, right? So I know them cold.
Right.
So not just the top ones, but also top tier is like the first many dozens.
Sure.
There are over 4,000 universities and colleges.
But when you say start in the sixth grade, people must go, this is Tiger Mom stuff, right?
Not at all.
It's not Tiger Mom stuff.
You go to some real Tiger Moms in Seoul, in Singapore, in Hong Kong, I tell you, they start when the baby is still in the womb.
I know. I've lived in all those places.
I've seen kids
higher as my knee who seem to have a busier schedule than I did.
I talk to any CEO friends of mine, right? All over the world, right? I talk to the ones, especially in these cities. Oh, five tutors, that's what I have. That's average per kid, right? But it's mostly academics. And I see a lot of kids and families with the best intention still engaging kids in things that I would not really do in that fashion. I would do things probably in a more optimal fashion. That's for me to know, people to find out.
Okay. Well, when we come back, I wanna extract from you a little bit of sense of what some of the tips are that parents can look out for, and also tell people how to get a hold of you if they want to carry this conversation further. You're watching Insight Indonesia, brought to you by the Jakarta Globe. Stay with us. Welcome back to Insight Indonesia. I'm talking today with Jason Ma from the company 3EQ, and we're talking about how to get kids prepared for top-tier United States universities. When we were in the last segment, we touched on this a little bit, but is it a matter of loading the kid up with math tutors, language tutors, violin lessons, et cetera, so that you pack their little brain full of enough knowledge? Is that sufficient to prepare somebody, some child, to be a leader?
It depends on the age, depends on the context of the family, depends on the direction that seems right. Now, a lot of families and kids are clueless, right? And it's fine. That's where I give them some directional guidance, right? Every kid, every family is different. And there are also similarities in terms of values, right? For a lot of families in Asia, especially, I noticed that, again, the parents have the best intention. They pack them to do a lot of violin, piano, dancing, Taekwondo, volleyball, ping pong, you know, squash, etc., all in one day. That's crazy. Okay, if I were a parent, I would probably optimize that equation a little bit more here. And you know, one thing that I've seen is a lot of parents and kids engage in a lot of activities, and then until they reach a certain age in high school, and with my guidance, then they realize that, oh my gosh, certain activities that we've been engaging in, the time, energy, and capital, and opportunity costs incurred. Now it's irreversible. I cannot change the history. Actually, by doing that, it has decreased their advantage. They thought that it was actually good for them. I got a lot of kids, right? So as I'm speaking right now, I got a small little army going to Harvard. I got all kids going to all top schools, right? We talk. They talk to me with exclamation mark, right? They're excited. And a lot of them are not necessarily great in music. A lot of them are not Division I. All of them are not Division I, Division II athletes, or not even in varsity in college. And yeah, a lot of them are quite talented in music or in sports, or of course they bring some special talents or special or pretty amazing impact, proven impact or accomplishments in a high school career. And they're proven to be potential strong leaders that tend to be easy to describe in a cocktail party. Socially, right? So a lot of them's got high grades, high scores, spectacular, and all that. Those are more qualifiers. But a lot of Asian families corner themselves in ways where they focus a lot all the time on test prep, which is endless, grades, and tutor this, tutor that. You do need to do that, okay? I mean, it's very important for kids to build very strong fundamentals, the ability to focus, right? My latest Forbes article talks about scattered brain, not good.
Well, we live in a scattered brain world in which our attention is divided by all these devices.
Right.
And I can imagine that has an impact on kids as well.
You do need that because kids need to be quite, in fact, kids these days on average, right, little tweenies. You know, I often think that, I hate to say it, but all my high achieving former students and current students are smarter than most adults I know. They're faster. They're faster, right?
Of course they are.
Yeah. I said, honey, why don't you train mom on doing certain things? Boom, done, right?
But before we run out of time, though, there's something I want to ask you, which is, I actually have two questions left. The first thing is, if you had to boil down what advice or the idea, what does it take to get into Harvard or Yale? What does it take? What kind of person does it take to get into those kind of places?
Right. There are a couple of earlies, I call it, here. I have another company that focuses in mainland China and the U.S., and we all agree that prepare and plan early. Don't wait until, you know, situations where you come in, I cannot fix your history. I see that all the time, even for high achievers. It's very sad for me to see. Kids that I feel who are capable with the right guidance from the right experts like myself, through the years, might be even high Ivy or Yale or Harvard, Princeton material. But if they get into only Northwestern, which is wonderful school, or Dartmouth, which is wonderful, but they are actually capable of going higher, then it's kind of sad to me, right? Start early, it's very important. Get expert guidance early on, years before, preferably even before high school, okay? And through high school is fine too. So you're a high school freshman, 20, time is still your best friend. Your high school sophomore, time is still your friend. You're a junior in high school.
It's time to start running out.
Okay, you're senior high school, I cannot fix your history.
Right.
Number one. Number two, I think 80% is really psychology. And then 20% is mechanics. Mechanics is very important, okay, your application forms and all that, which is quite, the application components are very complex. Those has to be mint, reflecting your best authentic self. Authentic, okay? No fake, genuine. You want to go up to be proud. You want to go into college strong. Not just get in, but go in strong. Not like 3 months later you call dad, daddy, I want to come home, I'm getting my butt kicked. That's not good, right? So a lot of elements here. On a psychology part, values, beliefs, skills, your self-talk, your attitudes, your confidence.
So it's really kind of helping a child figure out who they are and be able to express that in a confident manner.
Absolutely, at least have some direction. And then it's like your story has to be powerful. Or has to be convincing. Because these guys, by the time, at the end of the day, okay, these admission officers at these top schools, these guys are pretty irate, I'll tell you, because they are under a lot of stress.
Sure.
Each one of them reads so many applications. It's like, oh my gosh, another Asian kid who looks the same. What do you do? They're not gonna accept kids that look the same in the entire class, right? Their job is to build a well-rounded or diverse class of standouts.
And your job is to help kids who have leadership potential become those leaders and get into the right universities.
Part of that. More than that, a lifetime of leadership.
A lifetime of leadership.
And emotionally.
That's a good place to stop because we're out of time, and I don't get to lead the show if I don't stop on time.
Thank you so much.
You've been watching Insight Indonesia, brought to you by the Jakarta Globe. Today we've been talking with Jason Ma of the company 3EQ. It's very easy to remember, www.3eq.com, if you want to get a hold of Jason. The show is available live streaming on BritaSatu.tv and BritaSatu.com, and we put the shows online at thejakartaglobe.com. Thanks for being with us.